To introduce our next session, I would like to welcome the Honourable Penny Sharp, MLC, a member of the Labor Party and the leader of the government in the Legislative Council. Ms. Sharp is Minister for Climate Change, Energy, the Environment and Heritage, and her policy interests include public transport, the environment, education, women, LGBTI reform, and e-democracy. Please join me in welcoming Minister Sharp to the stage.
Janelle. I'd like to start by acknowledging that we gather on the land of the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation and pay my respects to Elders past and present. I also acknowledge that when the colony of New South Wales was being established, it was created without sovereignty being ceded by the Aboriginal nations that continue to exist with strong connections to country to this day. To my parliamentary colleagues, I think Gareth Ward is here, Hugh McDermott is here, I thought I saw Chris Rath before. I'm glad to see that there's a few who are here. Thanks to the Ash of the Black Rod, Janelle Moore and her team, for their work in planning and developing this conference. I know how much work's gone into this. I'd also like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the work of the Clerk of the Parliaments, David Blunt, and his team, who form the heart and soul of what we do in the Legislative Council every day. As well as keeping MLCs out of trouble, they provide the foundational knowledge and advice on the rules, policies and practices of our democracy that, while being little understood and sometimes referred as a little niche, they ensure that the Legislative Council fulfils its role as the House of Review, holding the executive government of the day to account. The stories gathered and shared throughout the commemoration of the bicentenary and of the development of the New South Wales Legislative Council tell us so much about where we have come from and give us some of the clues to where we find ourselves today. I like to think that we've learnt some of the lessons of the past, but I'm sometimes not so sure. This session takes us to the very heart of this conference, the 1823 Act that brought Parliament and the Supreme Court to New South Wales. In 1823, the British Parliament passed an Act for the better administration of justice in New South Wales and Van Diemen's Land and for the effectual government thereof. Between the 12th of June and the 18th of July 1823, the bill, and this is what Lynn's told me, the bill had a dynamic passage through the British Parliament. Often in the early hours of the morning, the bill was subject to postponements, divisions and petitions, an experience that those of us who serve in the current New South Wales Legislative Council are very familiar with. The bill polarised opinion of the House and to that extent reflected the prevailing and varying attitudes of members towards law, order and punishment. And, like all politics, in the end it was a compromise, with a sunset clause that finally passed in the closing hours of the session on the same day as Parliament was prorogued. Again, I can hear the history still coming down to this day in the way that some of the operations we undertake as we head into our last 2 weeks of Parliament for the year. To explore the intent of the Act and the complex processes around its passing, it is my pleasure to welcome our next guest speakers, Mr. Brett Walker, AOSC, and Ms. Lynn Lovelock, who is joining us online, and I believe that the tech is working. Brett Walker was admitted to the New South Wales Bar and as a practitioner of the High Court of Australia in 1979. He was appointed senior counsel in 1993 and served as the President of the Law Council of Australia from 1997 to 1998 and later as the President of the New South Wales Bar Association. Brett was Australia's inaugural independent national security legislation monitor and was the Chairman of the Law Council of Australia National Criminal Law Liaison Committee from 1998 to 2001 and continues to act as a constitutional law advisor to the Council. He has been appointed to several inquiries as a commissioner, including the Special Commission of Inquiry into Sydney Ferries in 2007 and the Special Commission of Inquiry into the Ruby Princess in 2020. Closer to home, Brett has been a trusted legal advisor to the Legislative Council, including when he represented the House in the famous Egan versus Willis cases in the 1990s, which confirmed the power of the Council to order the production of documents from the government. Now we'll turn to Lynn. Lynn is the former Clerk of the Parliaments. Lynn Lovelock joined the New South Wales Department of the Legislative Council in 1987, becoming the first female Usher of the Black Rod in 1988, Deputy Clerk in 1991, and the first woman to hold the distinguished role of Clerk of the Parliaments in 2007 until her retirement in 2011. She was the clerk to the Legislative Council Privileges Committee from 1991 until 2007 and was actively involved in the establishment of a parliamentary code of ethics and the development of procedures to safeguard returns of privileged papers before the House. Lynn has written widely in the fields of parliamentary law and practice, including as a co-author of the New South Wales Legislative Council Practice, the definitive record of the Council's rules and procedures. Again, very niche, but extremely important and something that I use very regularly. Recently, Lynn has spent time in the UK scouring early records to help chart the birth of the first Legislative Council in New South Wales while working on her second novel. To tell us more, I welcome the first woman to be the clerk of the New South Wales Parliament, and as the first woman in our 200-year history to serve as the leader of the government in the Legislative Council, I really want to welcome and thank Lynn Lovelock for all of her great work, mentorship, and I can't wait to hear the rest of her session.
Thank you very much, Penny. I'm assuming that you can all hear me because I can't quite see what's going on there. But I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we meet today, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and pay my respects to elders past and present. When I was asked by the former president, Matthew Mason Cox, if I'd be willing to research the parliamentary debates on the bill establishing the first Legislative Council, and in particular the reason it was included in the bill establishing the colony's first Supreme Court, when it had not been one of Commissioner Biggs' recommendations, it seemed like a good idea. I was interested, and how hard could it be in reading over some debates and checking out a few records of the proceedings? Little did I realise the large rabbit hole I was about to fall down. The passage of the bill itself was fairly straightforward. Known as the New South Wales Jurisdiction Bill, it was introduced into the House of Commons towards the end of the session, on Thursday the 12th of June 1823, by Robert Wilmot Horton, the Undersecretary of State for War and the Colonies. It was read a first time, printed and set down to be read a second time a week later, on Friday the 20th of June. However, by the time the order of the day on the bill was read, it was after midnight on the 20th. Rather than proceeding at that time, the bill was deferred for another week. It was finally read a second time on Friday the 27th of June, though no debate took place at that time, and it was set down for consideration in committee the next Friday, 4th of July. Later that same night, or rather early in the early hours of the following morning, the House resolved to send an address to His Majesty George IV, requesting a copy of Governor Macquarie's report of his administration of the Government of New South Wales. The following week, on the 2nd of July 1823, Sir James McIntosh presented a petition from Edward Eager, a merchant of New South Wales, against certain provisions in the bill, and praying that his counsel be heard at the bar of the House during the committee stage, a request to which the government objected. Both the attempt to refer the petition to the committee and the prayer to be heard at the bar were defeated on division. The next day, Thursday the 3rd of July, the House resolved to send another address to His Majesty, this time requesting a copy of the instructions given by Earl Bathurst to Commissioner Bigg on his proceeding to New South Wales. According to the House of Commons journals, on the 4th of July, the House resolved itself into the Committee of the Whole for some time. And when the Speaker resumed the chair, Mr. Brogdon reported that they'd gone through the bill and made several amendments. Those amendments were read to the House, and an amended bill was ordered to be printed. Further consideration in Committee of the Whole was set down for Monday, the 7th of July. Nothing of these proceedings has been reported in Hansard or in the newspapers, and the journal does not include details of the amendments. The first recorded debate on the bill occurred late in the evening of Monday, the 7th of July, on the motion that the bill be recommitted. After Wilmot Horton explained the principal provisions of the bill, a heated debate took place, principally concerning the merits of trial by jury. During this debate, Mr. Bright indicated his intention to move a this day 6 months amendment in an attempt to kill off the bill. According to the journal, the amendment was withdrawn by leave and the original question to resolve into Committee of the Whole to consider the bill was agreed to. When the Speaker resumed the chair, it was reported by Mr. Brogdon again that the committee had made progress and sought leave to sit again. It was midnight, according to the journal. Shortly before the House adjourned at 2:15 a.m., Wilmot Horton presented returns for the annual expenditure of the Colony of New South Wales and the instructions given by Earl Bathurst to Mr. Big, as requested by address the previous week. When the House sat again later that day, Sir James McIntosh presented a petition from a body of emancipated colonists complaining of certain disabilities. According to Sir James, the petition had been sent several weeks earlier, but withheld until now in the expectation that the bill would address their concerns. It plainly didn't. Further consideration of the bill was set down for later that day, but the House adjourned before doing so. It was not until late in the evening of 9th of July that the committee stage resumed, at which time Mr. William Peel, he's Robert Peel's younger brother, proposed an amended clause to confine to New South Wales those granted pardons by the governor. Despite opposition, the amendment was agreed to. The next day, the 10th of July, Mr. Brogdon reported the bill with amendments and a third reading was set down for Friday, the 11th of July. It was read and then sent on to the House of Lords. Proceedings in the House of Lords were more expeditious. It was reported on Friday the 11th, read a second time on Monday the 4th, taken into consideration in committee on Tuesday the 15th, for which it was reported without amendment by the Earl of Shaftesbury, and the third reading was set down for the following day. On the third reading, they tinkered with a few words, then promptly passed the amended bill and returned it to the Commons for concurrence. The Commons agreed to the Lord's amendments on the 18th of July, and the bill was sent off for royal assent, which was granted the following day, the same day as the Parliament was prorogued. Efforts to find the original petitions, the tabled bill, or any of the subsequently amended bills, or the marked up committee bill were unsuccessful. It seems they were victim to the Great Fire of 1834, which saw the Palace of Westminster, including both Houses of Parliament and much of the parliamentary estate, destroyed. It was the third largest conflagration in London, and it was caused by tally sticks, the use of which had become common in medieval Europe to record bilateral exchange and debts. Just showing you a picture of what the tally sticks looked like in case you were unaware of them. In 1872, an Act of Parliament decided that the records of the Exchequer, who had offices in the Palace of Westminster, were from now on to be recorded on paper rather than on these tallies. But it took until 1826 before the tallies were finally phased out, something described by Charles Dickens in an 1855 speech to the Administrative Reform Association as obstinate adherence to an obsolete custom. However, two cartloads of tallies were left languishing in the bowels of the parliamentary estate. And in 1834, the Clerk of Works was directed to dispose of them. Rather than give free firewood to the parliamentary staff, he engaged two Irish labourers to burn them in the underfloor stoves located in the basement of the House of Lords. Unfortunately, these stoves were designed to burn coal, not wood. Wood does have a lower heat, but it has a higher flame, and the resultant flames melted the copper lining of the flues and started a fire in the chimney. The fire didn't go unnoticed. People in the House of Lords noticed the hot floor and smoke coming up. The Clerk of Works, when he went down to check on proceedings, didn't realise there was a fire in the flue, couldn't see any problem with what the workmen were doing, and said it was all under control. By the evening, though, the House of Lords was on fire, a fire which quickly spread to the rest of the palace. Despite repeated warnings over many years that the palace was a fire hazard, including from a committee of members and in a report of 1789 by 14 architects, which included Sir John Soane, nothing had been done to introduce fire stops or party walls. The fire destroyed both Houses of Parliament, along with most of the other buildings on the site. The only buildings to survive the blaze were Westminster Hall, the Undercroft Chapel, the cloisters, the Chapter House of St. Stephen's Church, and the Jewel Tower, where since 1621 the House of Lords records were kept. The Jewel Tower had been built into the palace's defensive walls, but was detached from the main buildings, which is why it survived. This is crucial to the preservation of records such as Charles I's death warrant, but it also preserved the copy of the New South Wales Jurisdiction Bill, which was introduced into the Lords on the 11th of July, 1823. The House of Commons records were mostly destroyed, including, as I understand it, all the committee bills from 1810 to 1834. Interestingly, as you can see from these paintings here, the fire was observed by Turner, who made sketches using both pencil and watercolour in two sketchbooks from different vantage points, including from a rented boat, while John Constable sat in a handsome cab that had only been designed and patented that year on Westminster Bridge to render his famous sketch, which is the one in the centre there. The other factor that made the research difficult was the Hansard record itself. Much of what follows comes from the history of Hansard by John Vice and Stephen Farrell. Although today we recognise Hansard as an almost verbatim transcript of what is spoken in the House, this hasn't always been the case. For a long time, the Houses jealously guarded their proceedings, prohibiting note-taking and taking legal action against those who attempted to report on them. Nonetheless, by the early 19th century, reporting was a matter of accepted fact, although the reporters themselves had to contend with some serious limitations. There were no reporters' galleries. In the House of Lords, reporters were required to stand below the bar and were not allowed to take notes. It's unclear when note-taking was eventually permitted, but according to anecdote, sometime in the early 1820s, Lord Eldon accidentally knocked a reporter's notebook out of his hand near the bar of the House, and rather than remonstrating with him, bent down to retrieve it and handed it back. This was taken as a sign, particularly by the doorkeepers who would otherwise have enforced the ban on taking notes, that the reporter and his colleagues would not be hindered in their work. In the Commons, on the other hand, it seems that reporters were allowed to take notes from at least the last two decades of the 18th century, although they had to contend with members of the public to access the galleries, where the acoustics were notoriously bad and from where they often had difficulty identifying the members speaking. In the painting that's here by Hayter, you can see the gallery up above where the members are. The reporters, both from the newspapers and from Hansard, are in the back row because that's where, as I said, the acoustics are much better. And it meant that often they couldn't see who was speaking. This, of course, led to problems of accuracy. Not only did much of the reporting depend on memory, but there was disagreement over the use of longhand versus shorthand. Some argued that the parliamentary reporting required a higher calling that demanded greater powers, including literary talent, and that the reporter should take down notes in abbreviated longhand as rapidly as he can for aids to his memory. He must then retire to his room and, looking at these, recollect the speech as it was delivered and give it with all the fidelity, point and spirit as the speaker would write it out as if preparing for the press. With the likes of Dr. Samuel Johnson, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, William Hazlitt and Charles Dickens reporting, it's small wonder that some members' speeches from the period are so eloquent. It has been said, especially in relation to parliamentary reports from the 18th century, that the speeches feel more like essays than the words of politicians debating an issue, and that Johnson did not give so much what the speakers respectively said as what they ought to have said. Johnson, on his deathbed, allegedly recanted all his parliamentary writings, and there were significant doubts about the accuracy of his reporting. In 1819, just 4 years before the New South Wales Jurisdiction Bill was debated, Peter Finnerty, a reporter for the Times, was reprimanded by the Speaker for sitting in the front row of the gallery and telling the messenger who ordered him to stop writing to go to hell, while John Payne Collier, later convicted of literary forgery, had to apologise for serious misreport in a previous debate. His excuses, among many, were that he could not follow the member's argument because of the number of persons passing and repassing his seat, being misinformed about what had happened by a stranger seated in front of him, and the inconvenience arising from one of the reporters going on in the middle of the speech. This could explain why the Times journalist covering the debate on Monday, the 7th of July, decided to play it safe, reporting that Mr. William Horton then addressed the House on the order of the day for the further consideration of the New South Wales Jurisdiction Bill. He says, from the low tone of voice, however, in which the on-gent spoke in moving the recommitment of this bill, we were unable to collect the purport of by far the greater part of his observances. It is possible that Wilmot Horton provided his speech note to the reporters, for both the Times and the Hansard are almost identical from this point. However, the Times did add at the end, the on-gen proceeded to describe other parts of the bill, but he spoke in so low a tone that we cannot undertake to report what he said. And he concluded by moving that the bill be recommitted. Reporters were eventually allocated dedicated seats in the galleries in the new parliamentary chamber, rebuilt after the fire. Hansard itself, though, only became the official record of debate in 1878, and verbatim reporting only began in 1909. So what do we have of the debates? Well, the first one that was recorded was in relation to the petition that was presented from James McIntosh from Edward Eager. In presenting it, he explained that it raised two main concerns. Firstly, that the bill would deprive the colony of its most important privilege by taking away the right to a trial by jury and substituting instead a sort of court of martial imposed of a prescribed number of army and navy officers, which, and I'm quoting here, by a strange perversion of language, most facetiously called a jury. Secondly, that it gave the governor the extraordinary power of arbitrarily sending to England anyone who might be objectionable to him on the affidavit of an unknown informant without trial or any defence allowed. Sir James was willing to stop speaking then if there was no objection to the prayer to be heard at the bar of the House. But if there was, he felt he needed to say more. Of course, William Horton indicated that there were the strongest objections to allowing the prayer of the petition. So Sir James laid out the following arguments. He said the colony was no longer a mere receptacle for convicts, but the largest group of Europeans in Britain's Asian colonies. That in legislating for the rights of the colony, they should not entwine around such a principle the shoots of tyranny and arbitrary power, but remember what had been the fate of America, whereby importing early the free institutions of England, the state of America had risen to a degree of power which, for the rapidity of its growth, was unequalled among mankind. That the government's original intention had been to give trial by jury, and Governors Hunter, Bligh and Macquarie, as well as Justice Bent, had anticipated such. He also said there were sufficient numbers of landholders to provide for a jury, whereas there would be likely a deficiency of naval and military officers due to the regulations of service. That the governor's extraordinary power to arbitrarily transport a person to Britain on charges of sedition and treason, which he was at liberty to keep secret without trial or defence, was a power now almost unknown even in civilised despotisms and which was only used in the most barbarous tyrannies. Finally, that the equal administration of justice was one of the greatest encouragements to men in departing from the irregularities of their past lives to become useful members of civil community. William Horton felt this was not the time to discuss the bill. Don't forget, we've just presented a petition. And in declining to follow so what he called inconvenient a precedent, claimed the bill was necessary for the purpose of giving effect to the report of the Parliamentary Commission, and he did not see there were any grounds for hearing the petitioner at the bar. Those supporting the petition argued variously that the real question was whether the colony was to remain to them a useful auxiliary or become a source of inquietude and danger, and that the right to trial by jury was an invaluable privilege which brought the rich and poor into honourable contact, that several of the proposed regulations were harsh and injurious to the principle of civilisation, and that they needed more time to consider the bill. Others suggested that perhaps it was the wrong time to proceed, that the colony was not yet ready for trial by jury, and the House should at least hear from counsel at the bar. One went so far as to suggest that the instructions to Big should be laid upon the table to see how far he had complied with or exceeded his instructions. And as we know, that was when the address was sent the next day to get those instructions. Similar arguments were advanced on the motion for counsel to be heard at the bar of the House, with Sir James claiming the bill would see 8,000 freemen liable to be transported without trial at the will of the governor. William Horton, though, said he intended to introduce a clause that would limit the bill so that instead of affecting 8,000 individuals, it would scarcely extend to as many hundreds, and in fact would only operate on those who just completed their term of transportation, which, according to one member, would deny rights to any person who'd completed their punishment when they ought to have those rights returned. It was agreed that the petition be laid upon the table, but the motion to refer the petition to the Committee of the Whole and for the council to be heard at the bar was defeated on division 47 to 60. The next debate was on the 7th of July on the motion to recommit the bill, when William Horton explained the bill's provision in more detail. It's the one where he spoke so slow, so low that they couldn't hear him. He indicated that until now the settlement had been treated as a place to send convicts, but that following the commissioner's report, three places had been designated as proper for the foundation of the new settlement, including Norfolk Island, which was already being trialled, where they could combine what he called the two great and sometimes incompatible advantages of imposing punishment while rendering the punished useful to themselves and the state. He went on to say that too many guilty offenders look to transportation not as a punishment for their crimes, but as a better condition and a more fortunate existence, that the new place would establish a penitentiary on a great scale, where convicts would cultivate the land and raise and manufacture produce for their subsistence and clothing without the leisure or temptations of vicious indolence, which he argued would have the effect of reforming their habits and character. Bill also contemplating securing employment of convict labour in detached parts of the colony on a more extended and general plan than then existed, which would have the effect of separating convicts so they would not, as Commissioner Big had pointed out, relapse into the commission of crime. He concluded by saying that trial by jury was not contemplated by the bill. Henry Bright condemned this refusal of trial by jury and complained that the bill professed to settle a variety of objects too important to be disposed of at the termination of a session. After some further colourful and disparaging remarks concerning the legal system being proposed, he scathingly concluded, "As for the counsel given to the colony, what did it amount to? The members were appointed by the Crown, they might be removed by the Crown. They had not the power of initiating any measure, and a law proposed by the governor might, in some cases, be passed without their consent." He could not help believing that the bill, if it passed in its present state, would be a mischief to the colony rather than an advantage, and he should therefore move that the report be further considered this day 6 months. And as we know, though, he withdrew that. During the debate, members bemoaned the general corruption of morals in New South Wales, while others argued the merits of trial by jury. Mr. Peel claimed it was impossible that the details of the bill could have been fully considered by ministers, given the great press of other important business, and recommended that the pardons granted by the governor be limited to the colony, at least for the present time. During Committee of the Whole, several amendments were proposed, although only the attempt by Sir James McIntosh to replace officers of the Army and Navy to judge cases with the words "a jury of 12 men duly qualified to serve" was defeated on division 30 to 41. It's the only one that's recorded. The following day, Sir James McIntosh presented the petition from the emancipated colonists, which complained of certain legal disabilities arising from the government's failure to properly register their pardons. So, why do we have a legislative council? When it was introduced into the House, the bill already contained provisions for the establishment of a council to advise the governor, although, as we know, the only reference to it was by Mr. Bright during the debate on the 7th of July. The need for an advisory council was not something addressed by Commissioner Big in his report, so the question arises, why was it included in the bill, which, according to Wilmot Horton, was to give effect to the commissioner's report? Given the paucity of parliamentary records available, I turn to other records from the period, most of which are now held in the National Archives in Kew. I went through over 10,000 documents, the records of them, and went through a couple of thousand letters, a few thousand of which I've now read, and in them I found the seeds of our bill. First relevant document I came across was entitled New South Wales, Heads of Points for Consideration, preparatory to the same being submitted to Parliament. It was written by Francis Forbes, presumably at the behest of William Horton, and is dated 1 January 1823. Forbes had been the Chief Justice of Newfoundland from 1816 until 1822, when ill health due to the maritime climate forced him to return to London. While there, he was appointed the first Chief Justice of New South Wales, and prior to his departure to Australia, was asked to assist in drafting the bill. His suggestions under six heads, which are included on those documents you can see there, included revising the last Indemnity Act and re-enacting such parts as seemed proper, subdividing them into those that should be made perpetual and those that should be renewed for a limited time only, empowering magistrates to pass sentence on persons convicted of offences with retrospectivity for sentences already passed, including indemnity for the magistrates, with the colonial sentence to commence after the original sentence had expired. He's of the opinion that the governor had been exercising this power without authorisation from the Crown. The governor's pardon was to be subject to disallowance, with a time limit of 2 or 3 years to give certainty to those affected. In the document, he started with 3, but he scratched it out and added 2. The pardon, though, is only to operate while the party remains in New South Wales or its dependencies. A note between the paragraphs on page 3 of the document says, it will be necessary to declare the convicts who have not had the punishment of death commuted for transportation and whose sentence has been satisfied are to be considered as free then within New South Wales and England after the termination of their sentence. I'm presuming William Horton wrote that. The governor at the point 4 is the governor at the recommendation and with the consent of the magistrates or a majority of them expressed in writing are to have power to pass rules and ordinances for the regulation and good order of New South Wales, not repugnant to the laws of England. These rules and ordinances are to be subject to disallowance within 3 years, after which, by His Majesty in Council, that is, after which they'll be signified by the Principal Secretary of State for the Colonies as having received the royal assent. Margin notes, again presumably by William Horton, state that the governor must have a joint right of initiation, while another states that if the governor has the majority of magistrates upon an order initiated by himself, he shall have authority to pass the order, making special report to the government. To prevent the abuse of indulgence and to preserve the public's decency, the governor should be invested with the power or ordering and removing out of the colony any turbulent or factious convicts who may have been emancipated. That's point 5. A margin note adds, or who may remain in the colony after the term of their imprisonment. His last point was a provision defining the power and jurisdiction of the Supreme Court and to incorporate a short system of insolvent law based on the principle of the Judicature Act of Newfoundland. There are several pages of notes attached to this document headed simply by Mr. Forbes, in which he summarises the law regarding crimes which induce the forfeiture of estates, as well as a discourse on the efficacy of pardons. These points seem to have been the basis of the first draft of the New South Wales Jurisdiction Bill, which was in circulation by March of that year. On the 10th of March, in response to a request by Wilmot Horton, and apparently for inclusion in a dispatch to be written to Sir Thomas Brisbane, who was then the Governor of New South Wales, Forbes penned an 8-page document outlining for consideration, a document outlining points for consideration in framing instructions for carrying into effect the New South Wales Act. In the document, he expresses concern that under the legislation currently proposed, the Supreme Court will be called upon to sit in judgment upon the acts or ordinances of the governor and to determine whether they're lawful or not, something he believes is a situation of evident difficulty to both parties, and one that, with the very best feelings on both sides, may lead to a conflict of opinions, which, however amicably enforced, cannot fail to be attended with embarrassment. He goes on to explain that while the principle's not new, in New South Wales it will be called into peculiar action, given its institutions are still in their infancy and it's a penal colony. He proposes that before promulgating any ordinance, the governor be required to lay it before the Chief Justice to determine in writing whether or not it is repugnant to the laws of England. A margin note, presumably Wilmot Horton, adds, in other words, whether he would feel it to be consistent with his duty to maintain and enforce such ordinance in the Supreme Court if a question of its validity should be argued before him. Although Forbes admits that it might be abstractly better than that the person who is to interpret the law is not involved in its framing, he offers that all speculative principles must be controlled by expediency in adaption to practice. As for an ordinance as already promulgated, he again suggests that the Chief Justice make a written determination on their validity and suggests that when the Chief Justice is called upon to decide the legality of an ordinance, he should do so in the spirit of the law, with a leaning towards the ordinance. 3 days later, on the 13th of March, Forbes writes a private letter to Wilmot Horton, intended just for his information. He says he's made alterations and explanations which seem to be required in the draft of the bill, but draws attention to two matters in particular relating to appeals to His Majesty in Council, both of which he thinks require a little reconsideration. He goes to some length to explain the difficulties such appeals can cause to colonial courts when their judgments are overturned. He concludes with a request to Wilmot Horton to minute at the end of every suggestion on the New South Wales bill, whether it's approved or not, as it will be his guide in putting it into form for Parliament. I wish I could have got hold of that bill. However, by May, when Forbes is asked to make observations on a proposed alteration to the part of the draft bill prepared by him relating to the legislative powers of the governor, he's quite dismayed. In a letter dated 15 May, he claims that instead of conferring power to make local regulations upon certain defined subjects, the alteration is going to give the governor an undefined and general power, with the approval of any six magistrates of the colony, to make laws upon any subject matter and to any extent, provided such laws aren't repugnant to the laws of the parent state, and shall not be disapproved by and not disapproved by His Majesty in Council. According to Forbes, this would give the governor and any six gentlemen holding this office at his will a power as ample as the governor's council and assembly in Jamaica, able to create new felonies and even to raise taxes. In an effort to dissuade them from pursuing this course, he warns that such an unlimited control over the persons and settlers may operate against the government's intention of encouraging the investment of English capital employment of British industry in the colony. It's apparent from the bill that was brought before the Parliament, though, that he was unsuccessful in this. I'll finish here and leave Brett to address the contents and import of the legislation itself. Thank you.
Lynn, thank you so much for that fantastic discussion. Can I invite Mr. Brett Walker, AC, SC, to the stage?
The experience of preparing and arguing Egan and Willis and Egan and Chadwick had rather imbued me with the notion that as fundamental propositions of European government in this country, notions of, perhaps aspirations towards representative democracy and responsible government were the foundation. How wrong I was then, how wrong I am now to view so complacently our beginnings. What I really should have been more precise about in my thinking in preparing such arguments is that from 1855, those two aims might be seen as aspirations informing an understanding of our systems of government. And with representative democracy in particular, bearing in mind that in 1823, it was entirely not non-representative and anti-democratic. It's worth remembering that in 1830 there were violent attempted revolutions, particularly in France, got rid of one dynasty, got another one. And in 1848, as Sir Christopher Clarke has so brilliantly described in his recent book on the 1848-1850 revolution, counter-revolution in Europe, there was a plethora of attempts to introduce representative democracy, usually by attention not only to constitution making of a kind with which we're familiar, but also by reference to the franchise, the suffrage. And there were some spectacular gains in suffrage in Europe not very long after 1823. On the other hand, they were geometrically massive rather than in any absolute terms. There could have been a factor of, in some cases, 7, 8, even over 10 in terms of the expansion of the suffrage, but my reading of it is that it was the expansion of the minuscule to the tiny that was involved. And so, though we ought, in retrospect, judge rather harshly, or at least with no particular congratulation, the constitution making exercise of 1823. And while we should not regarded as in any sense even a spark towards representative democracy. It was, I think, not so bad compared to the kind of organised despotisms that one saw throughout Europe at the time. King of Prussia, after all, was not particularly interested in what his parliament would tell him about anything at that time. And as to responsible government, it can be seen from the provisions to which I'm going to come in dwelling in some detail on them in the 1823 Act. It was in default of a special regard for dispatches to Whitehall, it was a system of complete irresponsibility. That is, no check or balance within the settlement or colony, if it was perhaps by then a colony, no check or balance that could not, at least in the period for dispatches to sail to England and disallowances to come back, there was complete autocracy for the governor in manners I shall explain. But perhaps one could pick up the notion of the spark, the figure of speech with which our seminars are graced, by, if I may, politely suggesting it doesn't really tell the story. There was no conflagration started, in my opinion, by anything that constituted the spark in 1823, and perhaps one is reminded that in the days before safety matches, you did have to generate a spark which would actually catch fire. Many a spark would not produce anything. And I can't see myself, and I can only speculate as to the lost debates that Lynn has talked about, I can't see that there was any move towards representative democracy in a form that we would even passably recognise as such, or even, strange to say and perhaps disappointingly, responsible government in the sense of some body and superior power to which ultimately the executive would answer. In short, the executive was the executive of the United Kingdom, and the notions of disallowance in particular made it quite clear that everything done in this place would be provisional. And of course, with respect to the freeholders who were at the heart of the notion of some selection for those who would ultimately in 1842 rather than 1825 become, if you'd like, represented by a minority on the council originally, a majority in 1842, one is to remember, and here I make no excuse for anachronism, that they were all male. None of them was a traditional owner of a square inch of this land, and none of them could be the convicts who were, of course, the subject matter, the object and the purpose of the original penal settlement in 1788. In short, exclusivists and emancipists were not so much parties as non-mingling tribes. And it's quite plain that the basal notions of representative democracy or even a representative government were entirely lacking from the considerations that produced the 1823 Act. And insofar as there may be those, I stress not myself, who see some rigid separation of powers as critical to the kind of governmental system to which we pass ritual praise, may I stress, as has already been noted by Lynn, that the Chief Justice was conveniently on the Legislative Council, at least from 1825, and it was the Legislative Council, of course, whose assent or dissent, in particular assent, might be used for what might be called routine lawmaking by the Governor, all subject to the repugnancy provision to which Lynn has made reference and to which I now turn. It's to be remembered that the tradition, long established and flourishing from the North American experience, was that the laws of England, including what was grandly, in rather compendious fashion, called its constitution, were carried with colonists insofar as they could be adapted to meet the new circumstances in which the colonists found themselves. This was, to put it mildly, for a population in a penal settlement, the majority of which were figuratively, if not literally, in chains, a rather large adjustment to be made, and one which left, of course, out of account one of the things which has become the topic of Fustian rhetoric about our English heritage, namely the right to trial by jury. Lynn has already made reference to that. I can only commend, in order to introduce you to its lively account, in particular chapters 5 and 6 of Dr. Greg Woods's History of the Criminal Law in New South Wales, the first volume, The Colonial Period, which contains a very lively account of what occurred with respect to the rather unsatisfactory jury system when those firebrands Wentworth and Wardell in their then newspaper of 1824, that is The Australian, criticised the then new Governor Darling, who was, how shall I say, not progressive or liberal by any stretch of the imagination, as being, at least by oblique reference, an ignorant and obstinate man. The writer was nicely oblique and, in effect, wondered what would happen if the Home Government were to send an ignorant and obstinate man to rule the colony. There were criminal libel proceedings as a result of the 1823 very unsatisfactory compromise about which you've heard. There was no jury of a kind that we would recognise as a jury. Rather, there was the jury of 7 officers that had been inherited from the pre-Commissioner Big exercise and continued because, as you've heard, in Westminster, it was not considered that conditions were propitious for the carrying with the colonists, the enjoyment by the settlers, including the emancipated, any of the rights and protections that would come from the interposition of a jury between them and the power of the state. One can imagine why the word facetious was used to describe the appellation of a jury for the 7 officers sworn. But before one gets carried away with regarding such a jury as being a mockery, it's to be recalled that the 1824 criminal libel proceedings, so well described by Dr. Woods, resulted in a discharge because the jury firmly said they could not reach a decision in the first trial, and acquittal on 2 of the 3 charges and a hung jury on the third in the second trial. Now, these were trials for criminal libel by the governor against the newspaper. And by the time of the second trial, there'd been official orders given to the military in the colony to the effect that those officers serving on the jury who did the right thing would be well regarded, and those who had done the wrong thing will be held to account in due course. How anybody could ever have supposed that this represented to the slightest degree what one would expect from the proper and impartial administration of justice, albeit in a penal colony run by military officers, really ought not to be dismissed as my anachronistic amusings on our inadequate foundations. They were seen at the time, and one recalls what Lynn has told us about the petition. Well, they were seen at the time as utterly inconsistent with the ambition of achieving in this greatest aggregation of English colonists in this part of the globe a proper footing for a proper development of a decent society. The reaction of Governor Darling as a mark of the kind of regime that the 1823 constitution, if you can call it that, set in train, led to his imposition, one is sure, out of chagrin, of a newspaper tax of a kind that two centuries before John Milton had inveighed against in Areopagitica. The freedom of the press being, of course, more spoken about than practiced in England, but nonetheless having been the source of extremely significant both legislative and legal conflicts, in particular at the end of the 18th century, the beginning of the 19th century. Governor Darling correctly understood that a sufficient tax would rather muzzle his critics, including Wentworth and Wardell. But Francis Forbes, Chief Justice, with the disallowance power, to which I'll come briefly, of course, stepped into the breach, declared it a tax of a kind that was to be disallowed given the particular provisions that restricted the right to rate tax to being taxes appropriate for local purposes, and no doubt called in aid, of course, as well, the significance in the English common law tradition, as was no doubt misleadingly, but nonetheless persuasively invoked, of a free press. That had happened in 1827, and I think that it is the kind of development which suggests that the 1823 Constitution, in the technical regards to which I now turn, just might, if not being a spark that caused a conflagration, at least be regarded as having permitted further actual social experiment of a kind that would in due course lead to the much more significant 1842 exercise, but of course as the true creation of a parliamentary democracy and responsible government, the 1855 Constitution. It's to be remembered that the rather self-serving preamble of the Act, described, as has already been quoted to you, its purpose relevantly being for the more effectual government of New South Wales. I'm leaving references to Van Diemen's Land out for various purposes, some including the fact that there was a separate treatment in 1842 for it. But in 1823, this more effectual government, it's to be recalled, was to replace a penal colony in which there, how shall I say, was no amount of logjam and no difficulty of moving from decision to execution. There was, after all, just one person, the governor, always military in character and disposition, which constituted the executive government. And I say executive government because, in truth, it was a government entirely of an executive. The only legislature to which it was, in the modern sense, responsible was, of course, at Westminster. And 1823 left that utterly, completely undisturbed. It did not represent a step away from the letters patent with which the First Fleet set out in 1787. It is to be remembered that even as to the judicial inauguration, which enacted in 1823, coming into operation in 1824, is the traditional place of this Act in our legal history, it's to be recalled that there was no Act of Settlement tenure. And I won't, given the time, pause on the details, but it's to be remembered that the King was permitted by that Act to remove and replace judges as seemed expedient. How fortunate we are that nobody had that notion, or at least successfully carried out in the case of the man who became Sir Francis Forbes. The technical apparatus of the inauguration of the Supreme Court is one that our speakers tomorrow in particular will expatiate on. It suffices to say that with the signal exception of the question of juries, both civil and criminal, most importantly, of course, criminal, there was a very self-conscious and very thorough replication of references which were then regarded as adequate and in large part proved to be so, so as to set up a superior court of record of a kind that would enable the administration of justice as fully subject to the important question of juries as was enjoyed, if that's the right word, in the home countries. But when one comes to the so-called jury of seven commissions officers of His Majesty's Sea or Land Forces to be nominated for that purpose by the Governor, who, while open to challenge for interest, were certainly not open to challenge for being commissioned officers, and subject, of course, to military discipline, a familiar difficulty in latter days, of course, with courts martial. Those matters all breezed over by the requirement that the jurors deliberate, but without a need for unanimity. Provisions for appeals are not such as to be needing to be dwelled on. Suffice it to say, they were ultimately, domestically, focused on the governor with the advice of judges, but just the advice, or otherwise, off to, in effect, the Privy Council, something which means that on any view of it, the speedy dispatch of appellate business in this country has been greatly improved since 1823. There was provisions for inferior courts upon which, given the time I won't dwell, suffice it to say that the enticing reference to civil juries, which were in fact available, simply shows what an extraordinary state of affairs, what an unimaginative understanding of the position could be a proper criticism of those who in Westminster determined that though there might be, by local experiment and local assent, civil juries for what I'll call inferior claims, there could not be criminal juries, notwithstanding that in a penal colony, the significance and solemnity, the gravity in life terms of conviction and punishment could scarcely be understated and must have been better understood in the households of New South Wales than in the households, I suspect, of England. The purposes of this Act, more effectual government, being so disappointing, I should say, with respect to representative democracy or responsible government, nonetheless illustrate the rather fraught conflict that existed between those who could be badged emancipists, with some difficulty perhaps enlisting Governor Macquarie in that camp, and those who were rather proudly badging themselves as exclusivists, including, and not limited to, of course, the egregious John MacArthur, not, if I may say so, a living embodiment of constitutional rule of law enthusiasm. It needs to be remembered in the really important provisions, which are 24 and 25 of the Act, sections 24 and 25 of the Act, that there was set up as the Legislative Council something which in its essential character is, I'm glad to say, opposite from the Legislative Council which still exists, which I would date, with apologies, to 1855. It was in 1823, as opposed to 1842, it was an appointed body. It was a body which, on the face of things, in the first of the three possibilities laid down by Section 24, able to join with the governor by means of what was called advice to the governor in the governor making laws. There was provision for them to dissent and dissent could be met with two possibilities at the behest, in the first instance, of the governor. The first was that the governor would accept the consent. The second is that the governor, if it appeared to him, they were all men, of course, for the time that such proposed law was essential to the peace and safety thereof, and cannot without extreme injury to the welfare and good government of the colony be rejected, then if the governor had just one member in favour, that law would be effective, subject to the pleasure of the Crown, which would be known after, of course, a double maritime excursion. But there was a third possibility, Section 25. In case of rebellion or insurrection, words that are not only old-fashioned, in case that it shall have actually broken out, or if in the judgment of the governor there shall be good and sufficient cause to apprehend that any such rebellion or insurrection is about forthwith to break out. I quote, I would love to have, as long as nobody's heads were broken, I would love to have argued the availability of that power. Good and sufficient cause to apprehend that an insurrection is about forthwith to break out. Then it would be lawful to make any law which may be necessary in suppressing or preventing, any such rebellion or insurrection. Quote, although every member of the said council, the Legislative Council, should dissent from any such law. So that reminds one of the Achilles heel of the Weimar Republic, the emergency power of which Carl Schmitt speaks so forebodingly, in his case with optimism, in many other people's case with grave pessimism. That is, power is in the hands of the person or the institution with the power to declare an emergency. And we had in Section 25 of the 1823 Act, not uniquely, but we had in full form one of these emergency powers, which most constitutionalists nowadays would regard as a fatal flaw in any system for representative democracy or responsible government. With respect to responsible government, one of the most important characters of a far-flung Antipodean colony or penal settlement was, of course, that things had to operate in the interim while permission was sought or disapproval notified from Westminster. In the meantime, the repugnancy question, see Section 29 in fleshing out what Section 24 empowered, required initially the Chief Justice in 1842, it became all the judges, to have an opportunity to consider a bill and then to certify whether or not it was repugnant to the laws of England, or whether it was, and I quote, consistent with such laws so far as the circumstances of the said colony will admit, unquote. And that, of course, called into play the jurisprudence and political science of the notion of the reception of the law of England into its colonies, differing, I regret to say, not simply between those colonies of conquest and those colonies of session, but also carrying the seeds of the vicious jurisprudence by which ultimately and later, after this time, terra nullius became the means by which the law of England bound the uncivilised savages who were found in occupation but not apparently in ownership of the land, according to latter-day apologists. None of that, I stress, informed, so far as my research is can show, any of the thinking concerning the reception of the laws. And it seems obvious that the reception of the laws of England always involves some consideration as to how they affect and with whatever adjustment might be necessary, those who were already here from the beginning, that is, aboriginal. And it does seem that in those few words, a familiar phrase of such colonial constitutions in section 29 and 1823, the seeds of a form of judicial review for constitutionality, that is, for competence of lawmaking, was introduced with no great fanfare and with nowhere near, of course, as much recourse as modern judicial review on the American style adopted by our High Court is available and is practiced nowadays. So my summation of the actual operation of the 1823 Act, historical as it no doubt is that it's not to be treated as historic in any benevolent sense. It was an extremely modest, rather reticent response to what by then were well known to be disquiet at both the exclusivist and emancipist extremes, almost joining in the middle, for a better system of government that was provided by the autocratic military governor. On the other hand, the creation of a far more appropriate judicature, the understanding of the importance of juries, though the complete disappointment of requests for that in the case of crime, and the notion that there would be public good to be gained by advice from a council, albeit not binding, albeit not a body to which the governor was accountable, and albeit without any pretense at representative selection, all of those might be seen as what might be called pre-embryonic steps towards what we now enjoy. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Brett Walker and Lynn Lovelock, for such insightful, such fascinating presentations this morning. We have about 5 minutes for questions. I am very conscious, Lynn, that it's about 1 a.m. on Sunday night, Monday morning, your time. Thank you so much for staying up late for us. I guess you could think of it as an old-fashioned parliamentary sitting day. Being this time.
Indeed.
If we have some questions in the audience, please raise your hands and we'll get a microphone to you. Or online. Yes, we have some questions online. If we could get a microphone up to... Okay, we've got a question in the middle of the back row there. Yes.
Hi, I just have a question for Brett Walker. Just getting back to juries for a minute, where you mentioned perhaps a uniquely Australian relationship and insight into juries and the criminal law, in that so many people in New South Wales would have had a direct personal kind of a visceral relationship to the criminal law, and perhaps would have been in a better position to comment on the solemnity of the role of the jury. Did anybody ever consider ventilating that idea a bit further? I mean, we've heard that Australia and New South Wales was open to ideas from the world, but did we ever consider that perhaps the role of the criminal jury and the value of trial by your fellow citizens was something that we could have told the world a little bit more about?
Well, my researches and reading over quite a period don't suggest that there was any generous offering by any emancipists, or for that matter, children of emancipists, in New South Wales to the world or the British world of politics concerning their admiration of and gratitude for the institution of the jury. And it has to be said, in busy lives, that probably was a low priority. My comment about that is not so much that this was a ready resource, as we might now think in retrospect, of real and lived experience, which could have and should have been availed of by the great and the good in Westminster. I really cannot see any plausible possibility that there would have been any, to use the word of the time, respectable emancipist who would have been listened to in saying there ought to be proper juries in New South Wales, because after all, I and others like me are here because a legal system justly, properly and correctly convicted us and made us liable to sentences, very often, of course, of death to be commuted for transportation. And I can't bring myself to criticise their reticence in that regard.
Questions? Yes, Professor Roberts, I think. Down the front here, in the second row.
Thanks. I'll ask a quick question to Brett as well. Brett, you're a little bit almost disparaging about the clauses in relation to rebellion and insurrection, suggesting that these are old-fashioned notions, but they certainly weren't in 1823.
Oh,
this is the middle of the great age of revolution. So, I mean, surely there has to be some power in that legislation to allow a governor of a convict colony to take extraordinary decisions against the advice of his council.
Yes, it's probably best not to put it in constitutional form, which is such an unreviewable emergency power. Don't forget, there was no simultaneous power for a court to review that opinion. I did not intend to disparage a governmental concern with rebellion and insurrection. There were lived examples of that for the British concerning their colonies, and of course, it was far more widespread than Britain. Rebellion and insurrection, of course, being very loaded terms to describe what in other contexts and by different people might be simply viewed as resistance.
Yeah, thanks. That's very well explained. Could I also ask a question of Lynn while she's up? those documents are excellent. I'm not sure that I've seen the letters to Horton, but there is some reflections by Forbes later on in 1828 when he's talking about his role in devising that act. And he says that the legislative component of it was decided really late. He said it was almost sort of put in as an afterthought. Are you aware of that? And at what point does that come? Because it sounds like until the advanced stage of the draft, they weren't intending to set up a legislative council at all.
No. It came about pretty much around May, when he expressed his concerns that the council was going to not be under his control, basically, because don't forget he's writing his draft to have the Chief Justice review everything, and he's the Chief Justice.
Yeah.
So what they've done is taken away his central role as kind of working out what's going to be law or not law, which is why I kind of liked his comment where he says it might be better if you kept a separation of powers, but obviously in New South Wales we're just going to ignore that.
Which turned sour, of course, in the debates between Forbes and Darling. And the Chief Justice is eventually removed from the council pretty much for that.
Yes.
Okay, thanks. That was excellent. And that's great research, by the way. Some really good news.
Oh, thank you. It was fascinating.
Well, thank you very much, everyone. I'm afraid that's time for us. Can I ask everyone to join with me in thanking Brett Walker for that extremely erudite analysis of the 1823 Act? And Lynn Lovelock for that, yes, as Professor Roberts just commented, that amazing research. Professor Roberts referred to correspondence dating from 1828.
When they're revising the Act.
Perhaps, Lynn, you might be able to go back to the archives of Kew and keep reading through the rest of Forbes' correspondence.
There's a lot more Forbes correspondence, but for the purposes of this presentation, it just wouldn't fit.
Well, thank you so much. You've done a wonderful service on behalf of the Parliament of New South Wales in what you've done over the last 12 months in this regard. So thank you, Lynn.
Thank you.